Hi, my name is Yasser Louati. I'm a French human rights and civil liberties activist. I'm also the president of the Justice and Liberties for All Committee, in short, CJL. So I would like to first thank TNI for their courage to host this event, and despite all the pressures they have been experiencing. And I also thank all my co-panelists for bringing forward their analysis in their respective countries. Now, speaking of France, before we even speak of Islamophobia and its structural drivers, we have to understand that the French Republic is actually not really a republic. It's a compromise between a monarchy and a republic. Hence, the obscene amounts of powers between the hands of the president and the highly centralized authoritarian nature of power or political power in France. So then, if we take a look at the current republic, which was born in 1958, the so-called Fifth Republic, it was born out of a coup d'etat during the colonial era, as Algerians were battling for their independence and experiencing bloody massacres all over their territory. Having said that, we see that the French Republic, as we know it today, was born from a coup d'etat in the favor of Charles de Gaulle, but also was born out of the colonial era. So we also have to question ourselves, what are the effects of the colonial legacy onto the Republic? And in France, we don't see any questioning of how the colonial practices of 130 years, at least for Algeria and more for other countries, how these practices have actually permeated the French Republic and in the functioning of its institutions. On top of it, we have hence a strong president who can decide whatever he wants with very weak checks and balances. We also have a weak parliament. We haven't seen, for example, presidents under the Fifth Republic being challenged by the parliament. Sometimes we saw a collaboration between the left and right, but it did not go as far as to stall a government for obvious reasons. And of course, the problem is that with the weak institutions we have allow for the government in place to divert the rule of the law and turn it into a tool of repression. For example, laïcité. We keep hearing about it almost on a weekly basis in France. It makes international headlines, but it's actually a very simple law. It's a 1905 law that was passed to separate the Catholic Church from its influence on the government, or actually to separate religion and politics. State neutrality, meaning that no religion can interfere into state affairs and the state cannot interfere in religious affairs. And that's why it is also a law of protection for minority religions, especially back then the Jewish and Protestant religions. Now, having said that, that 1905 law was never applied in the colonies. It was applied in France, okay, despite the bitter opposition of the Catholic Church, but Algerians could not benefit from it because the French government wanted to keep Islam and Muslims and clerical institutions under their tight control. The other problem is that we see the fact that multiple laws have been passed in the name of protecting, you know, French identity. So, for example, we remember that a 2004 law was passed to ban the Muslim headscarf in public schools, but that law actually is extremely, on top of being extremely repressive, is also highly symbolic because it allows the government to divert the rule of the law and to use it against Muslims. In 1989, for example, we saw the first hijab affairs in public schools. And back then, the Council of the State supported the right of those girls, saying that the French Republic was not meant to separate between kids and to pick and choose. All kids and are welcome, and no kid should be, you know, kept outside of the public schooling system because of their religion. Yet it was passed. The game is rigged because anytime we hear the law was passed, we forget in what manner it was passed. For example, the 2004 law was passed in March, but before that, there was a long sequence that allowed the normalization of anti-Muslim sentiment in France. For example, despite the Council of the State decision of 1989 to protect the civil liberties of Muslim girls in public schools, 5 years later, in 1994, under pressure of the secular fundamentalists, or what we call the laïcars, the staunch left-wing Islamophobes that we know today through various figures that we will not mention, we see that despite having been a minority, even a loud minority, within 5 years they managed to pressure the then Minister of Education, François Bayrou, who then passed a circular that was meant to allow director, you know, school, you know, principals to expel kids by accusing them of proselytizing their religion. Now, having said that, 1994 was not enough. There was also a long sequence of events, of course, fed by international events, the multiple wars in the Middle East. Then we had the 1995 attacks in Paris, 9/11. And in 2003, there was a report that very few people speak of called the Report for a New Laïcité. And this one called for a new definition of laïcité, pushing the neutrality towards public space. So we would go from the neutrality of the state to the neutrality of public space. And the author of that report, François Barouin, a conservative member of the political party Les Républicains, you know, close to Jacques Chirac and Nicolas Sarkozy, he said that after having won the struggle against the Catholic Church, quote unquote, now it is about time to tackle the rising visibility of Muslims. And this is where, you know, we see the polarization lines, because anytime Muslims become visible and political actors and sociological non-invisible phenomenons, we see that the state tries to bring that down and to change the rules of the games. So despite Muslims benefiting from the law on laïcité of 1905, here we have members of parliament calling for its and for a new definition specifically to target Muslims. And before passing the 2004 law to ban the headscarf in public schools, of course, they had to put in place a commission. And that commission was the Stasi Commission, and it was extremely rigged. Why? Because Bernard Stasi, the first day of, he was asked, he said, had we been asked to vote for a law on the first day, we would have voted against a law banning the headscarf in public schools. But after auditioning 103 people, it turned out there was an Islamist conspiracy against the French Republic. But what happened in the meantime? We had 103 people auditioned, yes, but the rapporteur, Rémy Schwartz, decided to only bring people who were staunch opponents to the Muslim headscarf in public schools. Of course, he made sure there were whites and Arabs, all of them opponents to the headscarf. So of course, if you audition 103 people and all of them say the same thing, that, you know, the Republic is in danger, what's going to happen? You end up believing you are in danger and you propose the passage of a law. But to make things even worse, Jacques Chirac in December 2003 spoke from Tunis and said, I am in favor, we should need a banning of the Muslim headscarf in public schools. So as the commission is being held and having not decided to come up with a decision, and as it is auditioning highly biased individuals, the president himself intervenes and says, we want a law. So that means from the beginning, they wanted a law. There was a political project, and thanks to the brutal media warfare waged by all kinds of media outlets in France, public opinion, which was split between 47 and 49% respectively in favor and against the headscarf in public schools, we had a combination of weak institutions, a rigged political game, an authoritarian political system, and we had extremely biased media, so much so that despite the millions of people marching against the neoliberal reforms of the pension reform of 2003, nearly 1,300 media coverage pieces were produced on the Muslim headscarf. But when it came to the social mobilization, there was only about 420 pieces of media coverage. So there was, of course, of almost three times more coverage of the Muslim headscarf and no coverage almost of the burning social issues, which brings us to Islamo-diversion, that in France it is extremely easy for the media and policymakers to create a Muslim problem to divert public opinion. And this points to the responsibility of the French media in France in their role to go alongside the government in place, be it left-wing or right-wing. On top of it, we see a convergence around Islamophobia, which means from the far to some portions, to some big portions of the far left all the way to the far right, we see there is a convergence and agreement on Islamophobia that, you know, we should approach Muslims as a potential threat, if not a real threat, to a national identity, national economy, and of course, national security. On top of it, we have a weak civil society. We lost the long tradition of strong mobilizations in France. And of course, we can say societies have evolved and have become more individualistic, but even in the 1960s and 70s, we saw that the so-called left-wing movements were extremely racist towards Arab workers. For example, in the 1970s, there was so much police brutality targeting Arab workers. There was so much discrimination and precarity facing them that when they brought the issues again, again, and again to the mother of all unions in France, the CGT, Confédération Générale des Travailleurs, CGT, the CGT didn't really take the matter seriously. It was only, yeah, it's evil, but you know, that will come later. It's only about the class struggle, and these racial questions divide the proletariat. Yeah, I know. So the 1970s, we also saw a split of Arab workers from the major unions because their matters were not being taken seriously. And we still see this today. As we speak, we know Emmanuel Macron is waging a political war against the visibility of Muslims that he calls Islamist separatism, but we don't see a left, a battling left, that is pushing back this racist narrative. Now, to conclude, let's take a look at the consequences of Islamophobia and why we cannot speak of France in other terms than the colonial republic. First, unemployment hits more immigrants than the white population. If you are not white in France, you are three times more likely of facing unemployment. Discrimination. If you are a Muslim applicant for a job, you have to apply five times more than a person who has a non-Muslim first and last name. If you are a Muslim woman wearing a headscarf, you stand 1%. You stand a 1% chance of getting a job. And on top of that, when those jobs are based on a self-employment basis, the government is trying to push for laws to ban Muslim nannies wearing the headscarf from receiving state contracts. Let's take a look at housing, for example. If you are an immigrant or perceived as an immigrant, you are three times more likely of having to wait longer than a year. And 38% of non-white applicants for housing have to wait longer than a year. This is what we call a social apartheid. I'm not using this out of nowhere. This term came actually from the Prime Minister himself, Manuel Valls, that of course the zoning in France is extremely racially biased. Now, if you move forward to state violence in 2015, 16 and 17, the state of emergency gave approximately 4,000 and plus police raids. According to the Ombudsman, 99% of those raids targeted Muslims, so much so that in 2016, 17 and 18, the UN constantly called on France to not to protect the rule of law in France and to not use Muslims as the scapegoat for terrorist attacks. And to finish, and this is again to show how this republic is a colonial republic and that behind the veil of universalism, we are just, you know, whitewashing white supremacy. Immigrants and sons of immigrants, they are 70 to 80% more likely of dying at a young age compared to the majority population. And why we should call this the colonial republic? The sinful birth of 1958, now born in a coup d'etat during the colonial era. If we go back to the French Revolution, at no time the birth of the Republic separated France from slavery, the colonial enterprise, and the hundreds of massacres in the West Indies, in Africa, and Asia. If we speak about the Republic as a unifying body, we see that it wiped out all regional identities, the people of Brittany, the people of Corsica to some extent, and all the people in the region in the southwest and center of France, because the French Republic hates strong identities. And of course, to finish, and I thank you for your attention, we have to keep in mind that what's happening today under Emmanuel Macron did not happen out of nowhere. It happened because there are structural drivers of Islamophobia that make it possible for the president to wage a political war against a minority and to mobilize all the tools of the state. The executive branch of power, the legislative branch of power, since we don't have an independent judiciary, the judiciary can be mobilized and is mobilized against Muslims. We have an extremely weak media landscape. Even left-wing media outlets do not give a platform to minorities to speak for themselves. And that's why the solution cannot be cosmetic and through, you know, individual campaigns here and there. It calls for actually an overhaul of our political system. And there is an opportunity because the Fifth Republic is crumbling under its own weight. And chances are we may see the rise of a new political political system in France, but that would require us to be ready when that happens. Thank you for listening.